welcome to you all. Hope you all in live stream. I'm Reverend Jim, if I've never met you. And now that you are Reverend Dr. Bob, we have a confession to make to you. And having grown up Catholic and with the good sisters of Notre Dame, we would have called this sins of omission, meaning things that you should have maybe have told, but you did not. So we are celebrating you today, and after Sunday service, we have a potluck brunch in the social hall in your honor. And there might be actual bubblies involved, both alcohol and non-alcohol, depending on your preference. So just we honor you. And I think it's appropriate that as we come back from our conference this week with this idea of legacy and future vision, that this is the day that we honor Bob and our legacy a little bit. As attached about the hip is River Barbara, who, do you know how much I depend on you two? No, really. And it's not anything you specifically do, just your presence. So, what do you know? So, legacy is an interesting thing. There's, I guess, the positive side of it, and do we like to use the negative word or the things that hold us back? Well, let's talk about the positive things of legacy. I mean, legacy in the sense of the people that are our legacy or the shoulders that we stand upon. It's knowing that you two attended Sunday service the second time that one was held for Light of the Mountains 33 years ago and have been ever since, and just kind of the lifeblood and legacy that is the positive stories that we tell. It's the stories that inspire us if we are having some difficult moments. And we told some of those stories certainly this last week as well, but the good stories that keep us going. And it tells us of who we are. And if you have just been a member or someone who came here the last few months or even the last couple of years, if you really want to know some of those great legacy stories, have coffee with the Grabowskis. You know, they're full of them, and just amazing stories that you would think, oh my gosh, I would never know that those are the stories that led to us coming here. So part of our legacy is some of those people that have been here. The duration is seek them out, get some of those amazing stories, and the longer you're here, the more stories that you have. RL arrived 20 years ago, a couple of years before I did, and you've got your stories, and I certainly landed here at an amazing time. And I think I have certainly been a mentor to young ministers through my tenure, and I think if they would have brought the story that I came into here, I would have said, run as quickly as you can. Just because of the circumstances, not of the heart and the tremendous things that are here, but when you look at it on paper, see, these are some really serious things that we need to go through here. But the positive thing about our legacy or legacies in general is a sense that overcoming, that dedicating yourself to a higher principle and saying that we are going to walk through this regardless. And that is the amazing thing about legacy, is to have those stories that we can just be inspired by when we, again, as we always do in life, as organizations face difficult moments. But the downside of legacy can be that we can use some of those stories to hold us back. I've said many times over the years that I said, what was the first things that you thought you should do when you came here 3 years back? And I say that my job was that for the cement, not to set. Meaning, when you create a negative story or a story out of trauma, and of course we all have traumas, difficult things in our life, you're not going to not have them. but it's easier to get a shovel with wet cement to get rid of it than it is to get a jackhammer a few months down the road and get rid of it. You can still get rid of it, but it's a little bit easier when it's still a little wet. You can just kind of say, well, we didn't mean to do that. And so we have our own story at that time, and you happen to say that the cement didn't sit. It wanted to, but it didn't. And as I look at our larger organization, Centers for Spiritual Living, we can labor and talk about their cement sitting for quite a bit. But what was amazing about this particular conference that we went to, I believe it was, it felt like we were truly finally just being done with that story. And let me give you this legend that some of you know. There was one site in my community and it was growing and great, and there was divisions and disagreements in the 1950s, and they went into two organizations. And 8 years ago, we came back to one organization. And that is really a simplification. It was drama to be had along the way. But ask me the coffee, I'll tell you about it. But, and what was great about this particular conference that we had, in a sense, feeling like we were truly laying that old story to rest, was so we came together 8 years ago in a group convention to do what I call the shotgun win. You know, it really kind of felt like that. And you're really aware of who belonged to which organization. You didn't have to wear name tags, like, oh, they're in that other organization. And as I was welcoming new colleagues that were fellow ministers, you're really aware of if they were, you know, those that they're meeting. You know, they were different. They had different ideas. And several groupings after that, there was this feeling of those are those people, here we are, we're in the same room with a glass of wine at the reception and pretending that we're all together and really happy about it. But it started to just slowly heal. And we recognized that in our legacy this weekend. And they said, we don't know when that moment was, but suddenly that the energy in the balloon had been deflated. And I started to think, it's been a long time that I started, when I would look at colleagues at conferences and retreats, that I would, you know, take them out. Okay, you're from that group, you're from that group. And we just said, we were just this group. And it seems like now that we can truly look ahead to the future, because it seems like we've gotten the bulk of that kind of work done as an organization. And what was also big about this particular conference is that, of course, 8 years ago, we had to vote in what we call our community spiritual leader. It's like, you know, our spiritual head of the whole denomination. And they are allowed to have up to 2 4-year terms. And Dr. Ken Gordon, who was from the other group, had been voted in 8 years ago. And it was so funny that when we were voting, there was, you had so many things you're voting towards. Like, who are they from? You wanted to get a balance. You didn't want the other group to get all the officers. And it was silly. But it was so funny. And it was like, oh, well, we have to balance this out. But Dr. Ken truly was the man for the time. I mean, he just had this vision of, like, sick and tired of being sick and tired. Let's just get over ourselves. It's finally just throw the cats in the bag and let them have at it and just see what happens. I mean, that's really what it was in a sense. And so he was finishing this weekend. He finished his 8 years, which is the length of his term, 2 4-years. And we voted for the first time in column C's our next community spiritual leader. And our community spiritual leader now is Reverend Dr. Edward DeLeon. He is the senior minister in San Jose. And Santa Rosa. And someone I've known for since the mid-90s. And I'd say we're somewhere between acquaintances and good friends, somewhere in there. And he is the right guy for the time. Really amazing. So the trick is not just, it seems so hard. And it just seems to show up about faith communities and not just ours, all over. I was talking to a friend of mine in Southern California the last week on the phone that I came in contact with. She is a minister in a different organization, different denomination. And she says, I'm really feeling the clock ticking right now. So they're really, she says, well, this church that I am a minister of, and it's the last 15 years, and I've changed ministers every 3 years, and I am at the end of year 3. And says there's always a dramatic event that forces them out the door. And she said, I really have been aware of this last, especially the whole 3 years, of trying her best to, in a sense, get that jackhammer and get the cement up so they can lay a new storm. I think she's going to be successful, but she's almost like smooth like, the clock is ticking, And our stories are like that. It's like, when we have a negative story, we almost can't get through. It's like we have tied ourselves, 3 years, time to create drama. Rid of the minister kind of thing. So that's part of the thing to be aware of in our own, I guess you say, negative aspects of our personal legacy, where we almost hit like clockwork, we'll give ourselves over to a negative parent. And that's the point where we just have to do something different. And part of that, that we only get out of the other aspect of this legacy week was looking at adventure. Sometimes I think the word vision is the most overused word in our vernacular. I mean, at first it seemed like so special. Well, I'm going there because I have a vision. You're going, couldn't even question. But now you go into a vast new place and they have their vision sacred. So it doesn't seem quite so sacred. And the 60-year-old at the Fry station really doesn't seem to be, living with the vision caught the wall. They just get more fries out. So it's overused a bit, but it doesn't mean that it's not something that is still special if we look at its true essence. But first of all, let me tell you what a vision is not. Vision is not a business plan. It's not an itinerary. I believe people misuse the word and say, I had a vision to form our center, to do this and do this and do that, and to raise money to do this program and that. That's not vision. That is the container of your vision. Your vision is a core idea that you will try to express regardless of what it is that you are doing in the world. So that in anything that you do, you can ask yourself, does it bring forth that core idea that I've set for myself? And here's two examples for Center for Spiritual Living of the larger organization that we have taken on this vision as well. So they have two things that are important. You've probably read this in all the material that we have at one time or another. This is one, it is our vision to help make the world a better place. And two, it is our vision to help people realize their own spiritual magnificence. Those are pretty broad. Purposeful. So in anything that we do as an organization, the larger organization in here, to ask ourselves, does it in some way help make the world a better place? Does it in some way help people realize their own inherent spiritual magnificence? And if it's not, it doesn't mean that we shouldn't do that. It just means that we need to change gears in our mind of what we think we're doing. So when you look at trying to make the world a better place, it is so broad. And of course, when we go in our minds, well, gosh, I need to save the world. I need to cure cancer. I need to, dig wells in Africa or something like that. But you can make the world a better place by simply making it your job to be kind in every personal interaction that you have. That would make the world a better place. Especially in those days when you're just, that coffee didn't even help. You know what I mean? And I just, that you're still kind. Even though part of you just doesn't want to be kind. Let's admit, we have those moments that you don't want to be kind because you're just in your own stuff. And so to make the world a better place is actually for you not to show up like that grumpy person that you are going to show up in. And the other, which I have talked about so much, of helping people realize their spiritual magnificence. And your job is to see it when they can't. And again, you're not going to like this, but best place to do this is on the news. When you see people that you want to throw your shoe at the TV set, it is your job to see their spiritual magnificence, and there's no exceptions. You say, well, this is my exception list. You don't have one. And so if you are serious in some form in your own verbiage to realize the spiritual magnificence of everyone and say the divine resides in every single person, there is no exception list. And even if they act badly, you have to see the part of them that is the presence of the divine in spite of themselves. And that makes the world a better place. No one said this vision set was easy. I mean, it's easy when we're having brunch for Bob to see everyone in spiritual magnificence. I can see that everyone here, unless if you take the last thing that I want on the plate, then maybe I'll be a little grumpy. But it's easy to see it here. It's easy if you don't turn on the news. It's easy if you just go hang out at Starbucks or Healy Coffee or something like that. It's when the road gets rough is when you do that real work. And that's where we make the world a better place. It's not in the easy spots. It's in the spots that seem to be more difficult. And one thing that I love that Dr. Edwards said in his quote talk that he ended the conference with, he said, I just want to get this right, he said, when something annoys you, it's yours to do. Really? And that includes what you see on the TV. Oh, it's too annoying. Well, there you go. You wondered what you're going to do this week. There it is. It's shown, came right over the television set. If it annoys you, if it bothers you, if you have energy around it, that's the part of the world that you have to step forward and help heal in some way, if nothing else, to just see the divinity in it, as much chaos as you may see. That is an important thing. But here is the amazing thing. When you, in a sense, answer this call, and it is a call. Often we use the word calling for me. Instead, we think people who are better than us might do. And no, I'm just doing what I'm doing. It's not a call. Reverend Dr. Kathy Hearn, who is an amazing person, who was the spiritual community leader for United Center Spiritual Living, one of the two groups before we got together, has really had a lot to do in birthing this process. She gave a little talk in introducing Edward, our new spiritual leader, at the conference. And first of all, I dismiss her so much. She speaks from such grace that you just can't help but be on the edge of your seat like this. And you just like, don't stop, keep going. You know, sometimes you're like, is the speaker never going to be done? Like sometimes this morning, like, dude, is the judge never going to be done? But she is like, you're like, no, don't stop, just keep going. And she was giving this great introduction for Edward as he was going to, accept this mantle, this being community spiritual leader, which is so daunting. And it was interesting to have a conversation with him before the voting. I just really love him so much. And he's absolutely the kind of person I want in leadership because he's what I call the reluctant warrior. He said, you don't want people who want to be on your board judge. You know what I'm saying? It's like they want leadership too badly. No, you got to be a little bit suspicious. He is definitely the reluctant leader, and I kind of acknowledge that with him. He says, yeah, I think you might be the guy who can't really help the reluctant warrior over here. But, and that's how we should be, because we think this calling is, I've been called. And I've just been given my nap, and I'm going to go to Starbucks and heal the masses today. It's not the way that it works. It seems to sometimes not even be a little walking. And this is something that Kathy Hearn had said, and we'll take it apart just a little bit. It says that when you answer your calls, you will be guided, you will be changed, and you will be a blessing. First of all, you will be guided. When you say yes from the bottom of your toes, and it really has nothing to do with human ego or even what you thought you would be up to in this life, when you say yes, to say hope is on the way. It really is. And here's one thing I've learned. It never seems to come when I think it's important. But it always comes when it really is important. I mean, how many times I spend in prayer like, I need guidance here, I need the answer, and it doesn't seem to come. But maybe as I'm driving down the road and I see this amazing sunset and I stop over just to look at it, and I'm just in that moment, and boom, it hits me. When you give an open channel, guidance moves. Just remember that sometimes we try too hard. Relax. Spiritual, you know, practice of meditation, but don't be like, oh, I just want to get enlightened. Just relax a little bit. As I teach my classes here, thanks to what I call the bathroom meditation. Stare out the lovely windows, we all get views with a cup of coffee in your bathroom, and don't think about anything. That's one of the best meditations you can do, and that's often when guidance will arrive. Second thing, you will be changed. We often don't realize this, and we think, I am here to follow a higher vision so I can help change the world. But guess what? The first thing you're going to do is you're going to change. You can't help change the world until you have changed in some way. That you will, by like they said, when you commit to a vision, you have just given spirit permission to just warm you over. And now here's me running for the door. Can we pop the champagne now? No, it is amazing. You will be worked over, and it will be in a positive way. And yes, you may go through some difficult moments because you are going to jackhammer that cement that you have set in there that you need to get rid of. But you will be changed. And as you are changed, you will show up in the world as a different presence in consciousness. And that makes the world a better place. And lastly, says, and you will be a blessing. Just take that in and accept it. It's so easy to say that, listen, I've got a blessing. Me, my best friend, you should really meet my best friend. He or she is a blessing. You should see what they're up to. In these simple moments, just realize it will just take you in and not in an egotistical way. Especially by just showing up and being kind. You are a blessing. It's just the truth. It's not handing one like that. And it's not an ego thing. It's just the truth. That for our world to be a better place and an even more amazing place, each person has to stand in their consciousness knowing that they are here to be a blessing in the world. No one is excluded from this. The only way that we can have a different experience is if we see the blessing in each other as well as recognizing it in ourselves. So that is the work to do. It's so interesting as I go to these conferences and I see what other sinners are doing or some of my fellow ministers, I think, God, I'm such a slammer. How is that? Billy Scholes in Vietnam and someone. It just gets down. What are you doing? How are you blessing them? How are you helping them looking at the places what's how are you seeing the presence of God? And if you're doing that, you're doing the best. So let's just take this. First, let's just give thanks for this amazing community. This amazing community that has been here for 32 years. There are many people who are not physically in this room right